The finance department also supporting calls for the temporary reduction of import tariffs on rice. Finance chief Benjamin Diokno says they are proposing to cut the 35% rice import tariff rate to between 0 to 10%. This is part of a comprehensive set of measures to help ensure stability, which also include the timely importation of rice by the private sector, the full implementation of the super green lane that will fast-track processing and clearance of shipments, and working with tollway operators to temporarily exempt trucks carrying agricultural products from the increase in toll fees. Diokno, meanwhile, expresses full support for the president's price ceiling executive order, which he admits caught him and NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan by surprise. He says the stopgap measure serves as a lifeline that extends much-needed relief to Filipinos. The Foundation for Economic Reform bats for the duty-free importation of rice. The group argues the increase in the price of imported rice has been the main driver of the spike in domestic prices of the staple grain. It says bringing the import tariff to zero could pull down prices of imported rice to 39 pesos per kilo. The group adds reducing tariffs on imported rice temporarily would help bridge the gap in supply and demand and address food inflation.
The reason why we cite it as temporary is because we acknowledge that there are other stakeholders in the rice industry, and they had their reasons for arguing for protection of the domestic rice industry. So granted, however, we believe that under the exigency of circumstances, namely the soaring price increases and much more expensive imported rice, it is timely to be able to at least temporarily repeal or at least dramatically reduce the tariff rate. Now, for those parties who are afraid of import surge, there is no need to fear, because actually, again, as I said, rice is unusually expensive, unusually and abnormally expensive in the last month up to the present. So that actually will boost the competitiveness of the domestic rice industry.
The price cap on rice might be lifted in the next 2 weeks. That's according to Philippine Trade Secretary Alfredo Pascual. Now, he says the government is expecting more rice supply in the coming weeks due to the harvest season and arrival of imported grain. Pascual also justifying the move to impose the highly contested price ceiling on rice.
The price cap was imposed. It was not a standalone measure. This was done alongside efforts to address the issue of hoarding, profiteering, smuggling, and cartelization. And there were parallel efforts to take care of these actions, anti-competitive market action. The law, so-called law of surprise demand, works in an ideal situation, you know, when there is a balance of supply and demand forces. If there is an imbalance, like a manipulation or hoarding, then some intervention would help address the balance. It's a solution that's called for given the circumstances within which this EO 39 was issued.
RC Balisacan.
As for former National Economic and Development Chief Chelito Habito, he believes the government must go after cartels instead of implementing a price cap. Habito also expressing disappointment on the leadership of President Marcos in the Agriculture Department.
This has to be measured in terms of how much does it cost our taxpayers. The problem is there's a thin line between so-called hoarding and really rice stocking. It's not enough to be looking for evidence that there's a lot of rice being stored in some warehouse and then say that's hoarding. As many people have expressed, the disappointment really is in that he was not able to give it the amount of time that really it demands. And in fact, I've always called agriculture the backbone of our Philippine economy. It's simply too important to be left. The time that was devoted by the president directly made it difficult to really get a clear direction from the Department of Agriculture.
Journalist Atom Araujo files a 2 million peso civil suit against SM&I hosts Lorraine Badoy and Jeffrey Celis over their alleged red tagging. Araujo was represented by attorney Tony Lavinia, of the movement against disinformation. The group says they want to hold Badoy and Celis accountable for their statements in the program that foment hate and violence against journalists. The National Union of Journalists of the Philippines throwing their support behind Araulio. It also condemned red tagging, saying it's being used to justify arrests and trumped up charges against human rights defenders. Back in July, Araulio's mother, Bayan Emeritus Chairperson Carol Pagaduan Araulio, also filed a complaint against Badoy over red tagging. More leaders offer to send help to quick hit Morocco. French President Emmanuel Macron says France stands ready to deploy technical teams to Morocco if and when the kingdom asks for it. A French citizen died in the tremor while 8 others were hurt. Turkey also on standby, saying hundreds of its aid workers are ready to travel to Morocco to help quake victims. Earlier this year, Turkey and neighboring Syria were also hit by a devastating quake that killed over 50,000 people. Meanwhile, at least 4 planes carrying rescue teams from Qatar are now headed to Marrakech to provide assistance. In Morocco, where the death toll from last week's massive quake has now climbed to over 2,100, but the extent of the damage and casualties remain unclear as rescuers race to reach more remote areas hit by the deadly tremor.
A security camera captures the moment a 6.8 magnitude earthquake struck Morocco as a man runs for his life through rubble. It was a common scene last Friday as the quake shook parts of this North African nation. Morocco's public broadcaster, SNRT, released images of cars crushed by rubble, highlighting the challenges facing rescue workers. Much of the quake's damage was in mountainous regions where villagers had already begun burying their dead as of Saturday. And as Moroccans and tourists visiting their country took part in blood drives at area clinics, Morocco's King Mohammed VI ordered the nation's armed forces to mobilize search and rescue teams. He also called for special prayer services Sunday at mosques. Many Moroccans have been sleeping in the streets for fear of aftershocks destroying their already damaged homes. The United States and others have offered support to the government and people of Morocco.
We've reached out immediately to the Moroccan government, made very clear to them that we are prepared to assist in any way that we can. We have the U.S. Agency for International Development, which takes the lead in our efforts, mobilizing, and we're waiting to hear from the Moroccan government how we can be of most assistance. But we're tracking this very carefully, and our hearts go out to the people of Morocco who suffered this devastating earthquake, and we stand ready to help in any way that we can.
For those living through the disaster, their government's efforts have not gone unnoticed.
Authorities are doing their best, and even like in the high Atlas Mountains where people lost their lives and where that earthquake hit harder, they're trying to help. And I'm very sure that our people, our Moroccan people and our Moroccan community can get together and we can go through this.
Morocco has not seen this powerful an earthquake since 2004, when a magnitude 6.3 quake killed more than 550 people in one of the country's poorer regions. Morocco's worst earthquake in modern times happened in 1960. It destroyed most of the popular tourist destination of Agadir and killed at least 12,000 people. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
Pope Francis offers prayers for the victims of Morocco's deadliest quake in more than 6 decades. He also urged crowds in St. Peter's Square to remember those who died in the tragedy.
I would like to express my condolences, so many of them, and for their relatives. I thank the rescuers and all those who are working to alleviate the suffering of the people. May everyone's complete support sustain the population at this tragic time. We stand with the people of Morocco.